my brow and I sweat my rust. I'm breathing in the chemicals.
Yeah, it works.
Good, how you doing?
Fine, and you, are you?
I'm doing really good, yeah. It's nice and early here. Where are you, in Paris?
I'm in Belgium.
Belgium, so, oh, sweet.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Small city.
Yeah. No, I loved, I've been to Belgium once before. I loved it.
Yeah, I think you coming back in Brussels next year.
Yeah, I can't wait. I love coming out for cons over there. They're just so much fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what are you doing to keep busy during this time?
A lot of just kind of working out. I think, well, the industry is about to start here slowly in Vancouver because, I think we're getting a little better up here. So some things are starting. So people are sending out tapes for auditions, et cetera. So that's getting a little busy. Who knows when they're actually going to film at some point. People are trying to get people in the idea of working again. I'm working on something next week and working out a lot.
are you sending a lot of audition tapes?
Yeah, basically a bunch of audition tapes. There's I believe two shows filming out here right now to start with a lot of COVID restrictions, pretty safe how they're handling it, a couple movies. So it's slowly starting up. We'll see where it heads because nobody has really any idea what's really happening. But yeah, audition tape for sure.
So you've been quite busy then.
Yeah, it's been, well, just for the last couple weeks. I mean, before that, it was just a lot of sitting, a lot of pasta, a lot of wine, just trying to enjoy. I think every week we had this great thing where we would set up this Zoom movie night with a bunch of our friends and we'd all just sit down and watch a movie together. Yeah, stuff like that. But the rest of it, I mean, you just sit down a lot.
And did you have some time to learn new things about yourself?
Oh, man, totally. I mean, this wasn't a reflective time. I think it could only be a reflective time because how often do you spend so much time with yourself where you literally can't do anything else? So it was really, really great. Played a lot of piano. Did a lot of reading of a lot of books that I wanted to read for you. Yeah, what did you read?
I read a lot of English books, actually, because I speak French. So during this time, I wanted to improve my English. So yeah, basically a lot of fictions.
Yeah. Because give me your favorite one.
My favorite one is, it's actually a sad story. It's called History Is Holy Left Me by Adam Silvera. And it's a gay fiction, but it's really sad.
Yeah, there's some great books out there that are like, they really tell a deep story besides trying to show just kind of only kind of light story. And I think some of the best stories are ones that show kind of the opposite side, more of a reality of things that people actually go through. And I think that's an important story to tell.
Yeah, sure. I started to read a book about, like the movement Black Lives Matter, but it's too complicated for me because it's in English and it's all history. So I gave up, but I'm going to buy it in French because for now it's really.
Yeah, it's hard to, the translation is difficult. I mean, right now, I think if you want to transition into that, there's a lot of videos and movies and stuff to watch to kind of get yourself introduced to that. But definitely if there's a bit of a language barrier, I definitely recommend reading it.
And about the Andrit, how does the pandemic impacted the filming of the show? Because, I spoke with Mary 2 weeks ago and she told me that you all barely had time to say goodbye to the show, to the crew, to the cast. It was very strange.
It was definitely very strange. We actually, on a positive side, because I like to always try to find the positive of it, we got to finish right as soon as it started. Because I can't imagine what it would have been like had the pandemic happened a week or even a couple weeks beforehand, because people were filming, whoever's in the last episode, was filming the last episode. So they got to finish the show so that it could air for everybody.
Yeah.
During the pandemic, which I think was so important and lucky. Yeah, you're right that we did not get to say properly goodbye to everybody, didn't get to have the wrap party, didn't get to do all that kind of stuff. So it was really weird too. It was kind of a really fast finish to make sure that the show actually got done. But I think more than anything, I'm just, I'm grateful that the show got to finish without having to make any story like concessions due to the pandemic at the end, or you know, they got to film every scene of the finale.
And I'm sure you will have plenty of time to see each other at events, guns. So there is a really good vibe.
Yeah, you know, what's great is on this show, we've made so many good friends that even if you're saying goodbye to people for filming, you're going to see them.
Yeah, sure.
You're going to hang out. You're going to enjoy each other's. That's the greatest thing about what this show has been, is I have some friends for life now that are just such great people that I continue to talk to all the time, that have really changed my life in such a positive way. Just because we've been through such a great 7-year experience together, that that's one of the greatest things, that even if it's a goodbye, I'm still talking to so many people from the show, writers, actors, everybody worked behind the scenes, crew, you know, we still talk all the time. So that's, we got really lucky with that.
It's like a big family.
We are just, a lot of us are a great family. It's really awesome.
And so in the show, you're portraying Eric Jackson, and your character happened to be gay and is in a relationship with Miller since season 5, I think.
Yep.
In the beginning, when you first learned your character's homosexuality, were you like some people who think that gay characters should be interpreted by gay actors?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, what's funny about this show is that we were kind of, there's a big change in the cultural movement of television. And it happened kind of in the middle of this show, wherein there was a lot of things that people were learning about culture and how things should be. And people were more vocal about representation and how things should be represented. And I definitely think there needs a lot more representation on television, with gay characters playing gay characters playing, you know, not gay characters. I think there's a huge blend of people representing each other as actors. We just need more representation. So for me personally, when I got that, it was an honor for me, because I get to represent Indians on television. I got to represent another marginalized community on television. So for me, I just wanted to do that to the best of my ability when that happened, because I don't think, you know, when stuff like that happens, when choices are made, you're just like, okay, I got to go with this and I got to do the best I can for that community in this situation as an actor, because that's my job. And I felt grateful and really excited to be able to do that.
Yeah, I think that's the right way to support each other, you know, put oneself in each other's shoes for a moment and understand that we are all equals. And I think it's, together is the only way we can progress, and definitely representation on screen is really important, and we need support from everyone for everyone, and every community for every community, you know.
And you make such a great point in that. I think from the beginning, a big thing about this show has been representation without looking like it's trying to, you know, represent, from casting so many different races from the beginning, from doing things to try to represent different groups all the time. And it's been very cool to kind of watch, you know, shows in general, as well as this show, try to do that, because I think it's so important in society now, when we're finally talking about the things that we've been thinking about for so long. If you're from a community that doesn't often get represented in the greatest light, that when shows do that, it's an exciting thing to be a part of.
Sure, it's true. And next to relationships, there are a bunch of fighting scenes in The 100, but we don't see Jackson fight a lot like Octavia did. Is that something you regret?
I think, you know, for Jackson as a character, it didn't make sense. He's a doctor, right? So if he gets in too many fights, he's got to have good hands. You know, he's a surgeon. He's got to have steady hands. So if he's constantly in fights, he's not going to be able to do his job perfectly. I think for the character, it totally made sense that he's not in too many fights. Sachin eventually would love to play a character that I think gets to do that, because I'm a very physical guy. You know, I like to, I box, I work out, I do all this stuff. It would be cool to be able to do some stunts. Try to do fight scenes, because that's always something you want to grow as an actor and kind of you want to put all different types of parts. But for Jackson, it didn't make sense to fight, and I think it made so much more it was so much more meaningful when he threw a punch when he thought Abby was going to die, you know, because it's not something you normally would do. So the one punch he did throw was like, oh my god, he threw a punch, you know, because you've never seen it. So it made that one much more meaningful.
Yeah, and was it you throw the punch, or was it a stunt?
Oh, it was me, yeah.
Oh, it was you.
I mean, it was a turnaround, it was a punch. I wouldn't even call it a stunt. I mean, it's not that hard. The stunt man knows how to make it look like I did something, so.
Oh, okay, and how is shoot a punch? Because you can't just punch your, I don't remember his name, but you can't just punch the actor. It has to be a fake, but
yeah.
A
lot of that is camera tricks. So if a camera is angled, so if you're punching here, if I'm going to punch this way and the guy's here, if you put the camera behind us, if I punch in front of his face and he moves, like he's going to get punched, like if you do that.
Oh, okay.
Camera wise, it just looks like you were hit. You know, so it's a lot of the way the camera is put and directed, and there's a lot of tricks to do that. And we have really good stunt people that make it look like I can throw a really good punch. So, and I box as well. So I think I know how to throw one from time to time. So, a lot of it's just camera tricks.
Okay. Yeah. And when there are fights, there are also death. And how did the death of some characters affected the ambience on the set? I mean, Paige, Henry, Christopher, Isaiah. When they left the show, it must have been a bit different after that.
Oh, it's always so sad when you lose someone that's been with the show for so long, and somebody that's great. I mean, you mentioned Chris, and Chris Larkin is such a great dude, and just him being in the city on off days really made you miss them, you know. The fact that, and when Monty was on set, you know, there's something about Monty in his script that when you read it, you get uplifted. You know, for me personally, the one that affected me the most character-wise would have to be Abby.
It was your partner.
It's like every scene, most scenes I would prepare for, I would be working with her as a doctor. And so when you come into a season for the first time and preparing for a scene where you're not working with the person you're used to working with all the time, it's so weird because it changes your whole frame of reference, you know, who you are in the scene, who you are to other people and stuff. So Abby's death and Paige's moving on from the show affected both Sachin and Jackson in a lot of very deep ways.
So you have, after Abby, you had to work on your acting, I don't know how to say that. You had to work more on your acting to, you know, discover a new Jackson without Abby.
Yeah, for sure. Because when you lose your mentor in life, I think that's a real big moment. And I think it was very important to play that he was a different person, because he was in a second phase of his life where not only did he become somebody that was looked on as the only doctor and someone that had to take care of people by himself, but he was also looked at as somebody that is grieving and is upset and angry at people, which is somebody that we've never seen in Jackson before. We've never seen that kind of version of him where he's pretty mad, you know, and maybe a little bit vengeful. Even if he doesn't necessarily do that, he's got something different in his heart because he lost his mentor in a way that was so painful to him.
And why do you think the showrunners have kept your character alive for now? And if they wanted to kill him, what would have been your argument to keep him alive and so you in the show?
I keeping him around, I mean, I'm grateful that they did. I think it's, I'm always so, I feel so, I mean, lack of a better word, I feel so hashtag blessed, because I was there from the first episode, and I think there's only five of us that were there for the first episode into the season, which feels crazy to me. But I'm grateful, and I think it's a lot to do with my ability to make scientific jargon come out really fast and say it. And I think that's something that I can do really well. And as a doctor and an actor, when you're getting through exposition, I think it's important. Also, I made so many great friends on here. So whatever the reason they decided to keep me around, I'm super grateful, and I love it, and I won't question it. And what was your other question?
The question was, what would have been your arguments to keep him alive in the show? And so you win.
Oh, my arguments.
If they wanted to kill him, yeah.
Yeah, he's the nicest guy. I mean, on this show, there's not too many people who don't have too much blood on his hands. And the only time he kind of did was when he took the chip because he thought it was going to be helpful. He didn't know it was being controlled by an AI at the time. But other than that, everybody's done some stuff, and I think he's done the least amount of bad things in survival because he's got such a good heart. And I think that heart is so important at times sometimes you need that frame of reference or that reason or that person that comes in and says, no, this is wrong. We can't be doing this stuff. And he's tried to maintain that Hippocratic oath from day one.
Yeah. And you talked about jargon, and in the show there are also, I'm gonna say, the Grandeur's language. I don't remember if Jackson speak it, but how does your co-stars and yourself, if you did, have learned a non-existent language? What was the process you've all been through?
The process is just like learning it and hoping when you get to the day. Because I didn't actually have to do it too much, so I was very lucky, but I know that everybody that had to do it, you have to learn it, and then when you show up, a lot of the times it just goes away because it's a made-up language as soon as action hose, because you get, as soon as somebody calls action, you don't get nervous, but it's like, okay, what were those words again? And it happens so many times, so you just have to work on it to learn it as diligently as possible. I mean, it definitely takes a lot of work. I don't know anybody that just picked up Grounder and was like, oh yeah, I got it. You know, sit there, learn it, read it over and over again, and hope you understand it and learn it.
Yeah,
it really helps when you know what you're saying, when you know what it means, because then you at least understand what the intention behind it is.
Yeah, that must have been pretty funny sometimes. I imagine that there were many times on set when you all had a hard time speaking that language, and so many laughter.
And those are the best days, actually. Those are some of the funniest days that I remember, when people are trying to say Grounder and it's just not there, because sometimes it sounds like so many different things. I don't remember who was telling me this story, but one time a grounder was coming in on a horse, and his line was "Shawty be like," and they just heard "Shawty be like," and from the every time he said it, they just burst out laughing, and you like can't finish the scene because you're hearing something else. Because imagine a guy's coming in, he's trying to tell you like there's a war coming, and he's like "Shawty be like," it just seems like just those are the best days.
And without spoiling, you can't spoil it. Are you happy with how the story ends for Jackson and for everybody in the show?
Without spoiling, I do love the end of the show. I think it's so great. It was unexpected to me when I heard about it and I read about it, which I think is so awesome. I love being surprised. You've done a show for 7 years, so being surprised on it consistently the way that they did is so awesome, because you're excited to get new scripts. So when I got the end, I was very, very excited, because I was like, this is cool.
Do you think we are all going to cry? No?
Yeah.
Yeah?
If you haven't already, you will definitely. Have your tissues ready for sure.
Since the end, I bet your life has change at least a bit. You're going to a lot of cons. You even have a nickname in France, Le Père.
Yeah.
And how do meetings with the fans of the show affects you? Are you still the same person you were 7 years ago, or because of the show you change?
Yeah, I think in reference to the fans, that has been one of the greatest things that I didn't expect to happen with the show, to connect with so many great people about it, because I think we're living in a great new world where you can connect with the people who watch the show a lot more and learn about some new great people that you never would have had contact with before, or hearing fans that have become best friends with people because of the show across the world. That type of connection to me is so beautiful. And it used to be so rare. And now we're living in a time where it's less rare. And I just loved, there are so many people that are coming in my mind that I've met over the course of these 7 years that I'm just so, so happy to have met, and watching the way that they love the show and live their lives is just really special. I don't think I'm too much different than before I got the show. I try to maintain a lot of I think who I am before the show. I like to live my life as if life hasn't really changed,
yeah,
personally, because I think that keeps me working really hard. But the show has changed my life in so many ways, in terms of being able to travel the world, in terms of being able to do different things, meet different people, and just live a different, you know, type of life. I mean, I'm looking around at my place right now, and I'm so grateful for all that it's given me. But I definitely try to maintain a certain semblance of the person that I was, because as an actor, you know, as soon as it's over, you got to work on something else, and you can't really rest on your laurels and be like, oh, okay, I did this, now I'm done. You kind of have to continue to working and think of your life as a first day mentality, you know, and that's the way I live. I try to live like it's the first day I'm doing this again, because that's what
it's not an easy path. I mean, you finish something, but you don't know if something is going to come up next.
I'm truly excited for what's next. I think a lot of people after 7 years of a show like this get really like either sad or worried because they're not worried. They're worried they're not going to work again or something. I'm just excited because I was as excited before this show to do this job as I am now. And yeah. I'm just excited to see what's next, whatever it may be in my life.
And was it sometimes boring to play the same character during 7 years?
I mean, never boring. There's never a day where I drove to set upset because I was always excited. And there's never a day I left where I was like, oh, I still want to be there. I had every single day I was excited to go to set. I love Jackson and I've always wanted him to live a full life. And I think that that's everybody. So I just wanted every day that I went there, I wanted to be able to live his full life as much as I could. And Yeah, it was just such a great time being there. And I think there are so many people that have told me, like, I mean, he got Sachin, they named the character Sachin this year.
Yeah.
You know, that to me is just so beautiful. And I the writers and Jason and all the people that I met over the course of years that have allowed me to be on this show for so long, that have kept writing for my character to grow, has been special. So I don't have any regrets.
And now, are you still surprised by the fandom? Are you still feeling strange when somebody recognizes you in the street or are friendly to you without knowing you in real?
That's a good question. I think it's always a little jarring to me. I'm always still surprised when somebody knows that I'm on a television show.
Yeah.
But whenever it happens, I'm just like, hey, how are you doing? It's nice to meet you. It's great. Because I think because we're connecting over the same thing. You know, I watch the show myself. I think I do this very differently in that I watch the show as a fan. I don't watch it as somebody that's on it because I love my friends. I love watching them act and I love the story of the show. So when I watch it, I'm not watching it being like, this is just a show I'm on. I'm watching it excited to see what my friends have done.
Yeah.
Because what's great about it is we're all so separate, right? So I don't get to see three quarters of the story because we all film in different locations and with different storylines. So when it comes on, I just can't wait to see how it was put on page to TV. So I just love connecting with people about the show. And if somebody watches the show and they see that I'm on it and we meet together, then I just love having that moment of connection with them.
I never met you, actually. This is the first time ever I talked to you because I watched 100 very recently. because it's stupid, but there are too many cons about the Android, and I was afraid to love the show for my wallet. And I was right, because no, I want to go to Space Workers, and I will be there at 100 con in Brussels. So
oh, nice.
I was right to be afraid, but yeah. I hope I will meet you, but I will meet you in Brussels for sure, and maybe in October in Paris. Until that, I wish you the best, and I thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, man. This was awesome. Great questions. I really enjoyed myself, and I can't wait to meet you. Thanks for watching the show.
Thanks to you. And I hope my English wasn't too bad, because sometimes I was a bit stressed. So
I never had a moment where I didn't think you knew perfect English. I think your English is fantastic. So whatever you've been doing to work on it, and whatever book you've been reading, your English is amazing.
Perfect. So yeah, maybe meet again.
Maybe.